And that's for me now the chance to invite our expert here. Good morning, Yukio.
Good morning.
Good to have you here. We will talk a little bit about sustainability. I think that's the topic at the moment. It's one of the highlight topics of the last Hannover Fair, but also it's our main topic here at Bosch Rexroth, besides from digitalization. So what is exactly the area you will touch today?
Thanks, Stefan. Thank you very much for having me. Welcome from my side. My name is Yukio Kamizu. I'm responsible for industrial hydraulics system solutions and digital services. And in the roughly next 40 minutes, we'll see the latest activities, developments, status of servo hydraulics and our servo hydraulics modules. We'll lead you through a journey towards how you can actually implement servo hydraulics, why we should all do this. And what was especially important for us was that we are going to show how we got to this point where we are today.
Exactly. So as you said, I think you will go a little into the deep dive, but I also urge you to have some application examples. So please prepare for this. But in the beginning, I would say modular servo hydraulics. I think not everybody is completely familiar with the topic. So maybe let's have a first entry here.
Yes. What we see here is the market trend. We come from throttle controlled traditional hydraulic systems where you centrally produce the hydraulic energy and transmit it via pipes, hoses towards the individual actuators, where the hydraulic power is then throttled to the prevailing load regime. On the other side, we have what we call displacement control. There, the electric power is transmitted to each individual axis and then transferred or converted into mechanical power on demand at each actuators. What's the difference? Let's take a look at the analogy of driving a car. On the right-hand side, on the left-hand side from your perspective, we see the throttle control. In the car, you would stay on the gas pedal. You would have the foot on the gas pedal all the time and then control your speed by braking because you throttle. With displacement control, it's the opposite. There we are actually driving a car like we all do, which makes sense, right? By having the foot on the gas pedal, and yes, we need to brake from time to time, but like an electrical vehicle, we can recuperate this energy, feed it into other actuators, store it electrically or kinetically, or feed it back into the grid. So the main driver, obviously, is energy efficiency, but it is important to us to show you in this webinar that there is much more to it, and also how we actually employ this technology. So, why? Like I said, energy efficiency is key. That's a no-brainer. Yeah? Reduction of energy cost, total cost of ownership. But what happens if we increase our efficiency? What happens if we reduce our losses? Reduced losses mean reduced heat emission into oil. So we need less oil. Less oil means we can employ smaller tanks. Smaller tanks mean less material. So it's better for resources. The footprint, now talking geometrically, yes, we discussed the tank issue, but motor pump, the overall geometry, as we will show later on, can also be significantly reduced and the valuable shop floor area is less blocked. Power on demand. The analogy with a car describes it quite well. We only consume as much as is needed. And a key issue here in this webinar will be noise. So we managed to significantly reduce the sound level of our servo hydraulic modules. And this leads to less expenditures for noise countermeasures. And thereby we create a better working environment.
For those of you that are following me on social media, I also mentioned in this topic, noise will be a special topic today. And I think we try something new. It's a premiere today. We are doing kind of a quiz. So let's start with this now, talking about noise. Yuko has prepared something. So what have you prepared?
I'm quite curious. This is an experiment we are doing. You're about to hear a hydraulic pump. And we just like to ask, okay, what do you think what pump type it is, what size it is, and at what speed it is running? So we have prepared a Mentimeter, and let's see what happened.
Yeah, we have some service guys here, we have some engineers, so let's see how good they know their stuff.
Maybe we can hear the noise twice or three times.
Let's play it twice, I would say, just to make sure we have it. Let's see what happens. You could go back one more slide. You could go now on menti.com again and answer the three questions about the pump type, about the size of the pump and the speed, and we will, let's say, reveal the results later on. Thanks for this. I'm really curious about this.
Let's see what happens.
So let's maybe continue now. We talked about servo-hydraulics, modular servo-hydraulics overall and the very relevant trends and the efficiency aspects. Let's dive a little deeper on what we have to offer.
Okay. Now, let's ask ourselves, how do we shape this trend? What you see here in this animation is our servo-hydraulic pump unit, SHP for servo-hydraulic pump. 4 for 4 quadrant operation and V for variable displacement. And as you can see, there's not much more to that video. That is a direct mounting on the manifold. We have here a direct coupling between the servo motor, MS210 standard motor, directly coupled to the A4. But this A4, like I said, can be directly mounted on a manifold, which saves a huge amount of piping and assembly costs. This servo-hydraulic pump unit comes with an integrated functionality, right? It's a compact power supply. It's a compact hydraulic power supply. So based on your needs, on the design of the machine, you can specify, okay, I need that hydraulic power. And then you can go into the data sheet and look, what do I need? And that saves engineering costs. We see in the video already, it's a modular design. It's equal parts principle, and our customers like that because their machines, they have certain power levels, they scale, and then you don't need to scale your engineering capacity, right? You just choose, okay, how many do I need? How modular do I want to make my machine? And then there's the topic of noise optimization, which saves noise protection costs. And now it's time for me to step out of PowerPoint and nice videos. Let's jump over to our press expert, Matthias Oppelt, and our acoustic expert, Stefan Backhaus, and they will actually show you an application and explain how we got there where we are.
Hello from the system testing area in Lohr. What you see in the back of me is a 200 ton powder press from the company Fry from Linktrees with a primary controlled press drive at the top ram and the tie. This drive concept makes this machine to one of the energy efficient powder presses in the market. Why this machine here? We see that our first solution did not meet all customer-specific requirements. Therefore, we designed different hydraulic concepts in the second step. The first hydraulic concept has some issues because there we have designed a closed hydraulic system for the top ram and for the tie with an integrated constant unit in the manifold. This leads to some issues with force holding because of the constant unit, we have higher torque and therefore we need a bigger electrical cabinet. And although we have some topics with services, because it was special services, because it was a pre-filled system, and it was not so easy to service pumps, to do filtration or to do cooling. I will show you the solution. We added an HPU to the drive, which enables us to boost the pumps with a higher pre-charge pressure, which enables us to increase pump speed, which makes it more suitable for a servo motor, which is also able to drive in higher speeds. The other thing is we use a swivel angel pump, which gives us the opportunity to reduce torque during pressure holding and reduces the electrical components in the cabinet. The other thing is we are able to have an open hydraulic system with the HPU, which reduces the service to a standard service like a hydraulic system. And the other thing is we were able to cool and filtrate in the HPU. So the solution we see at the machine has one topic, the topic acoustic, because of the high speed of the exhaled piston unit. How we solved it will show our expert Stefan Backhaus.
Welcome to the system sound measurement room in Lohr am Main. Here the acoustics development focus is on hydraulic systems such as servo-hydraulic pumps and hydraulic power units. My name is Stefan Backhaus. I'm the team leader of the acoustics team in industrial hydraulics and have supported the development of the SHP4V size 71 right from the start. During the acoustic optimization process, special attention was paid to the coupling of Bosch Rexroth servo motors with the pump. With the acoustics finite element simulation, the cause-effect relationship of the air and structure-borne sound excitation were examined at a very early stage of the development based on the previous version. The findings of the analysis were then incorporated into the design process. After completion of the unit, the successes of the simulative acoustic development could be first confirmed on the Frei powder press and proven in the sound measurement room. In the diagram you can see that the sound power of the press could be reduced by an average of 5 decibels. Since the sound power is already halved at a reduction of 3 decibels, the sound power of the press after the reduction of 5 decibels is only about 1/3 of the original sound power. By reducing the sound power of the press by 5 decibels, the surface sound pressure level is also reduced by 5 decibels. The following audible recordings of the sound of the press before and after the revision of the servo-hydraulic pump impressively show how strongly the level decrease also affects the subjective sound perception.
Wow, this was a very good insight, I would say. I think a lot of information and also about the noise reduction possibilities. Before we dig a little deeper into this topic, I would suggest that we would reveal the results, okay?
Sure, let's see.
So let's go to the Menti. So we have asked about what pump do you think you hear? And it's kind of a close game between an axial piston and a gear pump. So what's the solution?
It's an axial gear pump.
Axial gear pump. So almost...
Axial piston pump, sorry.
Axial piston pump. Okay. Almost half of it. And then now it's getting a little more tricky. We talked about it yesterday, so we're really interested in the second one. What nominal size do you think it is? A big majority for 40 cc. So what did you say?
71.
Okay. And I think that's really hard already to hear that difference. And now we made it even harder to talk about the speed. And here we also see a big majority. And again, I think it's not the right answer.
But this is very interesting because 1500 RPM is the standard speed, mm-hmm. right? But actually this was at 2000 RPM.
Okay.
Exactly.
So quite close, I would say. We have some people getting the right one. So yeah, it was an example, but...
Thank you very much.
Yeah, it was interesting for us to see. So now talking about noise reduction, I think you have prepared also another example or using this example to show the reduction possibilities.
Let's see how the subjective perceived sound looks like, mm-hmm. almost. Yeah. We should hear now the original sound, which was in the quiz, and then overlaid by the new sound of our SHP4V 71 running at 2000 RPM.
That's quite impressive, I would say. You can already hear, initially hear, the big difference.
Yeah, so it's 5 decibel and amazing result. I really like it.
Okay.
So now that we heard it actually, let's recap. What can we achieve? The footprint, yes, we have already mentioned higher speeds means smaller, more economic components. We can run at higher speeds than the traditional 1500 RPM. We have lower mounting costs, reduced expenses for installation. Efficiency, yes, by employing variable displacement unit for displacement control. We have power on demand, like I said in the beginning, with the car driving and braking and recuperating potentially the energy. Performance, Matthias mentioned it, long and efficient force holding is possible. Yeah? The variable pump displacement leads to a decrease of drive and motor size. And yes, the SHP4V is optimized for the use in closed circuit applications. Modularity, we saw it, it's easy to install. And the noise, yes, we heard it, it's a reduced acoustic footprint and lowers the cost for noise countermeasures.
Great. So I think we have now a very good feeling about the topic itself, and we saw already some examples. So it's time to get back a little bit to our participants. We have prepared two further questions for you. So the first one would be, how interesting are the topics overall that we talked about for you? And it seems like, yeah, a big majority, like my 90%, are very interested or interested. That's what we also hoped yesterday when we talked about it. So that's good to see. For the 11%, hopefully we have further content, so we don't lose you within the next 20 minutes. So, and then the second, or the question number 8, that's the last question for today for you. How much experience do you have with this? And we see quite some, I would say. Mm-hmm. Some of them have much experience, but I think you have a good target group for getting a little deeper into these topics. And now it's time to also have a look on the Q&As. So maybe there are some questions already popping up. So still no questions from the audience. Please make use of it that we have the expert here if you're interested. And there are obviously some people that are already experts also there. Feel free, place your questions. At the end of this web seminar, we will go back to your questions and try to answer them. Okay, now you said you're a product manager, you're a product guy. So let's maybe talk a little bit about the product offering.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what we see, I mean, yes, we explained the trend, why we have this trend, how we answer this, how we shape it. And we actually heard the machine, but what does it do actually? What are its key characteristics? Now this SHP4V, the Servo-Hydraulic Pump Unit, comes with a nominal size of 71, like we heard, with two types of synchronous servo machines, 10 and 13, with variable 2-point or fixed displacement. And I think the link to the data sheet you'll find in the description below for your information. What comes next is roughly, in terms of flow, twice the size and half the size with 180 and nominal size 28. Now, before going into the applications, let's have a look at the portfolio structure to really see, okay, where we are going, how to implement it in systems. We saw the SHP, the Servo-Hydraulic Pump Unit, the direct coupling between servo machine and A4 unit, directly mountable on a block. And if we mount a block, then it becomes an SHM for Servo-Hydraulic Manifold. Yeah. If we then add up one layer to reach a solution, then it becomes an SHS, the Servo-Hydraulic Solution. And you'll see the color code for each SHP, SHM and SHS. And how we derive this, I would like to explain a bit more detail. So let's go down the rabbit hole one more step. We asked ourselves, okay, what are the key topics by converting electrical power into mechanical power? What does the product structure look like? So we have four major topics here, major characteristics. One is the electrics and automation. You have the power supply infrastructure, the frequency converter. You need software or even condition monitoring with our CytroConnect solutions. Then in red, because it's the heart, it's the hydraulic power supply. Motor plus pump, in this case, the SHP. And if you need additional hydraulic control functions, like in a manifold, it becomes the SHM. And then, of course, we need actuators, whether it's a cylinder or a motor, doesn't matter to us. important is that we actually can control the hydraulic power at the end. Yeah. What we need, like we saw in the video, is also a boost HPU in order to allow the servo hydraulic pump unit to perform at its best. Yeah. We have this high speed, so we need to increase suction pressure. And now you could say, hey, Yukio, isn't this additional effort? Yeah? Isn't this additional effort to operate an SHP? I would say no, because we come from traditional hydraulic systems with huge HPUs, and many of our OEMs have, or customers have, other auxiliary functions as well, may it be clamping or other motion functions, yeah, which are conducted hydraulically. So then it's basically almost a no-brainer to adjust some power, or to duct some power to the SHP in order to allow it running at higher speeds. Yeah. And from the product structure, we said, hey, let's generate integration levels so that we easily can pick and place the color codes towards individual applications and see how or what our customers demand for components, yeah, for modules.
So I like the setup. You see the modular approach. I think we learned a little bit or a lot about the product structure itself. But in my pitch, I urged you to also let us know and let you participate, let us know about possible applications. So I think you prepared some application examples.
Sure. Okay. Sure. And that's key. We see here on the left-hand side the integration levels. And now we can pick and place the colors and create customer individual solutions. Like Matthias introduced the powder press from Company Fry, or we can use it for stone presses, or in the bottom here, multi-SHM solutions for larger forming applications, ring rolling machines, larger presses. And also what we managed to do is integrate everything what you can see as integration level into a small compressor drive, which you can easily put into your container if you want to compress gas like hydrogen.
That's already a good start, but we want to get a little deeper. I think we have experts here.
For sure. I brought now three different types of applications. Two from the press branch. We have a top ram, draw cushion or die, and a compressor drive like introduced before. So if you really wanted to, you could actually drive all the three applications from one power supply, here depicted with our control X inverters. Yeah. And now let's have a look at the top ram. It's driven with a tandem cylinder. The tandem cylinder is characterized by an easy switch over from press motion to fast motion. In case of the draw cushion, what we see here is a differential cylinder. So here we need to take care of the differential volume from the rod, right? So that we need to handle. But here we also have a nice feature that when the top ram hits the draw cushion and pushes down the draw cushion, then we can recuperate actually the energy, yeah, and feed it back into the top ram. So this leads to an increased energy efficiency. The compressor drive, characterized by a double rod cylinder, easy for that kind of application because it's a symmetrical consumer, right? So there's no differential volume we need to take care of. But the challenge in compressor drives is really to go fast to the end stop and come as close to the end stop as possible, as fast as possible, obviously not hitting it. Yeah? But we have great dynamics in our SHP, or in this case, it is actually an SHM, that can achieve high frequency, high accuracy. So overall, the applications we can realize are highly dynamic, highly flexible. You can see the layout here. There's a high repeating accuracy. We have the potential of recuperating the energy. In case of compressor drives, really compact, quiet, and precise, and the power density is great. We have 70 kilowatt continuous power on a square of 70 by 70, roughly centimeter square.
So what I like here, that you go down to the schematic structure for our experts, that you also have this color coding. I really like a lot, so you can see the modules behind, and that you already started with the advantages. So you maybe can sum up again the major advantages for our customers using this technology.
Sure. So what does it mean for you? It's a sustainable innovation. The SHP, you could argue, Yukio, that's nothing new. I would say you're absolutely right. Displacement control is state of the art. State of the art, it's nothing radical, but we employ this, we deliberately choose to go this way because known service concepts apply. It is no new component in itself, it's innovative packaging, but it comes with higher performance and with greater economics. What's important for us is that we and that you, that we all can simply and easily apply this in multiple branches. May it be presses, may it be gas compression, or even plastics in blow molding. Here, noise, sound emission is really important. Simple engineering, we saw the modular sizing. It's also easy to integrate into existing hydraulic system because it actually makes it smaller. And it's an implication of well-known, proven technology. It's a sustainable solution. We've seen reduced environmental impact. Carbon footprint, less oil. It's a robust technology based on our, for me, gold standard A4. And it's a reduced total cost of ownership that we all care about. Yeah. And at this point, I would really like to thank all the colleagues, Matthias, Stefan, who did this great video. Also, thank you very much, Stefan, here. Thanks to marketing in the background. We and our colleagues move for you to really push this technology to make the best out of it. And without you, we wouldn't have happy customers.
Thank you so much, Yukio, also for you. And I think this was a very, very interesting insight because we tried the quiz and we did a good, impressive video with exclusive insights on our noise lab, for example. And I heard already in the discussion we had that customers can come by and have a look over there directly. So
yes.
If you're interested and if you are in the near of Lower Main, you can come by and contact Yukio. And
you're
contacting you is, I would say, the handover to the last topic. Where can I find more information about this?
Yes, that will be in the description or in the PowerPoint presentation. We have the data sheet, we have technical information, how to apply SHP in the press branch. We have cabinet information, but also what I would really like to highlight is a white paper by the press manufacturer Laufer. Here you really see how they achieve 40% energy reduction, how they achieve huge best accuracy. It's for me, it's really a must read, definitely a good thing.
Great. And what I really like that you also placed yourself here. And now it's up to the customers, I would say.
Exactly.
You decide if you would come back to us and if you want to get more information for this. So again, thank you, Yukio. I think it was
very, very
impressive. And now we see it's a little time. So let's go back and have a look on our Q&A, if there are any questions coming in. And at least one question was there. So why use variable displacement pump with frequency drive versus frequency drive and fixed displacement pump?
Matthias explained it in the video. I think it will also be made available on YouTube later on, how we actually derived our solution with a variable displacement. Yeah, because if you have to employ long, precise force holding, there a variable displacement pump really gets the most out of the electrics, because you can downsize the electrical machine. You can downsize the torque which is necessary to operate the electrical machine, and it's just a much higher efficiency.
Yeah. Okay. So I think that will answer the question. And that's basically it, I would say, for the questions for now. So again, thank you, Yukio. Good to have you here.
You're welcome.
Hopefully sometimes we will see you back.
I think it was a pleasure.
It was very good. So yeah, for the end, I would say nothing more. You can find the information as usual on our YouTube channel in some days, I would say. You will get the information once you've registered. You will get the deck of slides also. And before you leave, I would like to ask you to sum up some feedback questions that we have prepared. It's about 3 years now we're doing this format, but we would like to ask you further questions, so maybe we can show the feedback questions very quickly, if you could answer them in the next minutes. And during the meantime, I just can tell you there will be a next event already in May. So by the 25th of May, there's a next meeting about service metallurgy. So hope you will step by, you will get invited as usual, and you will get also, you will find the link on LinkedIn or on our website. So thank you again for participating. We were a little bit faster than planned. So hopefully you will use the next 10 minutes for getting your coffee or your water, and stay safe. See you then in about 4 weeks. Bye-bye.